good, yeah, you think so.
Yeah.
I think I should do it, yeah. Well, good day to you here in Carrick today. It's a joy to be here in your midst to bring to you the glad tidings, the joyful news, the best that's ever come to be heard in this sin-filled and sin-cursed world and town of yours here in Carrick. No different to the rest of the nation. The cleansing, decline, defilement, all manner of wickedness and uncleanness, debauchery, and all, of course, all lies at the root of your unbelief, godlessness, ungodliness, wickedness abounds in your nation, in your society, and in your town here of Carrick today. Men and women perishing without knowledge, perishing in their sin, day by day, ushered into your crematoriums and into your graveyards, dying in their sins, lost not just for time but for eternity, and all for the want of faith in the good news, the gift of God, his Son, sent into the world that sinners like you might be reconciled to God, but not without faith, and not without faith in Jesus Christ. He is the way, and he is the only way. No one enters into God's sheepfold but by Jesus Christ, the Son of God. He's the good shepherd. Following him, hearing him, believing him, trusting in him, confiding in him, only get you entrance into God's sheepfold. All those who seek to come another way and by another name are, Jesus says, they are thieves and robbers. Let no man thieve your soul. Let no man rob you of eternal life. Hear the word of God. Believe the word of God. And receive eternal life in the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ. If you like a copy of God's Word, it's the only thing that's free in Carrick today. If you'd like a copy of God's written Word, that is, feel free to come and ask for one. Freely offered to you, no cost, no obligation to you. You're simply not in for the taking. Still, that you can read, meditate upon the person of God's Son, Jesus Christ, sent into the world to live and die, rise again from the dead, yes, alive from the dead. God does still raise the dead to life. You better believe it, because if you do, if you confess with your mouth and believe with your heart, says God, that he raised his Son from the dead, you shall be saved. But if you do not believe, you will not be saved. So my question for you today, what is the use of God's moral law? The Ten Commandments are a summary of those of that moral law of God. We are moral creatures, that's how God made us, with a moral accountability to God. And of course you have a conscience that tells you that, without me telling it to you. You have a conscience that tells you that. It approves of you when you do right, and it disapproves of you when you do wrong. Your conscience testifies to the things that I speak to you of today. But the use of the moral law, well, it's of much use. It's by the law comes the knowledge of sin. That's how men and women come to a realization of the wicked sinners that they are, how far away they are from God, how much they've declined, how unclean, how filthy and dirty they are, morally speaking, that is, before God. And of course, bringing them to that realization would send them would send them to Jesus, send them to the Son of God, in order that they might be washed and made clean, in order, that is, that they might be saved, that they might receive eternal life. So what use are the commandments to us today? Some people would say, well, that's old hat, that's old fashioned. We've moved on from that now. We have a modern society. No, you have a society that's just the same as the world ever was. No change, unbelieving, wicked, ungodly, unrighteous, and unholy. It never has been any different. You may paint it a little bit differently, you may look at it a little bit differently, but it's just the same godless world. Sin came into the world by one man, and of course, sin and death has passed to all men as a result of that. And so in every day and generation, men and women are conceived in sin, they're born in sin, and they live in sin, and they die in their sin. Unless that is, the free grace of God comes to them and saves them by the preaching of the gospel, that what I'm doing here today. So it's nothing to do with modern, it's to do with your declension, it's to do with your decline into unbelief and into all manner of sin and wickedness. World's not changed, still lies in wickedness, says God, and that's what you need saving from. Your own sin, your own wickedness, your own unbelief, the world and the devil, the god of this age who blinds the minds of the ungodly. So what is the use of the moral law of God to men, the commandments of God? Well, they tell you the truth about God, you know, that he's not a Santa Claus, you know, he's not a white bearded old gentleman sitting in a cloud just waiting to ooze out forgiveness to you. You know, or what you want, you know, what you lust after, what you desire, just when it suits you. No, my friends, you want to know what God is like, you want to know the will of God, then you go to the moral law of God. It will tell you, it will teach you, it will instruct you. The commandments of God given to inform you as to the truth about God, his holy will and character. He is holy, very holy. He is described in the Bible as the thrice holy God, who is of purer eyes than to behold evil, who sees even your righteousnesses, yours, yes, the best of your efforts. He sees them as filthy rags in his sight. He's a holy God, and he hates that which is unholy. Maybe a surprise to some of you in Cannock here today. Maybe you live with this delusion, you know, that, well, one, maybe your delusion is that there is no God. Well, that needs curing. And maybe the other delusion that you live with is, well, you know, God loves everybody. Well, the Bible says he doesn't. He hates workers of iniquity. He hates those who shed innocent blood. So you see, my friends, there are people, there are some folk that God hates, and God is determined that they will never be saved. But of course, that's not everybody. There are those whom God loves, those whom God sent his only begotten Son into the world for, to save them, to deliver them from this present evil age, the wickedness of this day and generation even. So you see, the commandments of God, they teach you what God is like, that he is holy, absolutely holy, and without holiness there's no seeing him. Unless you're holy, you'll never get a sight of him. You'll never get inside his presence unless you're holy. And you can't make yourself holy. You're the very opposite. You're unholy, unrighteous, ungodly, separated, alienated from God by your unholiness. So unless you're made holy, So who could make you holy? Who could make you righteous? Well, the Bible says that God made his son Jesus Christ sin. He who knew no sin, he made him sin for those who believe in his son Jesus Christ, that they might be made righteous, righteous in the sight of God. You see, my friends, God sent his only begotten son into the world to suffer and die, to bleed and die, in order that sinners like you might be saved through faith in the Son of God, made holy, washed and made clean, no longer alienated from God, separated from your best good, but brought back to God from the dark path of sin. So the truth, you see, you would know perhaps God's will. Well, it's here for you in the moral law of God. It's here for you in the Ten Commandments. Read them. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, he says. Away with your heathen religion that you've filled your land with today. And then, of course, other commandments like it. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Yes, it's still a commandment. It still stands and abides forever. Heaven and earth may pass away, but the law of God shall never, never pass away. The Sabbath day, the first day of the week, Resurrection Day, the Christian Sabbath, it's to be observed by all men. So, my friends, when you do your football, when you do your leisure and your pleasure on a Sunday, instead of being amongst the people of God and worshipping God, the triune God, in spirit and in truth, you're a breaker of the Sabbath day. You're a sinner, a wicked sinner, and God will judge you for it, for your Sabbath breaking, for your heathen religion. God will judge you for more. And then the commandments go on to tell us, you know, if thou shalt not kill, whether by means of abortion or by means, you know, of a dose of morphine when you're aged, terminally ill, euthanasia they call it, end of life treatment, murder God calls it, thou shalt not kill, God says, nor by means of violence either. So you see, my friends, those commandments, they teach you the will of God, what you should do and what you should not do. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, the fornicating, sexual practice outside of holy matrimony, leaving your spouse for somebody else's, you know? The lust that fills your generation with fornication. Not only natural sexuality is practiced, but even the perverse, even the deviant, sodomy and lesbianism, all contrary to the commandment of God. Thou shalt not, says God. Thou shalt not. So when you say that I shall, you go contrary to God, but that's your nature. That's your nature, you see. That's the nature you need saving from. That's the nature, my friends, that only God can transform and give you a nature that's agreeable to God's moral law, to his commandments, that is. So, very profitable indeed, I tell you. The moral law of God, the commandments of God, they teach you the holy will of God and his holy character. That he's a sin-hating God and he will have nothing to do with sin, nothing to do with your sin. And so unless you get rid of it, before you breathe your last, before you cock your toes up and go out of this world, unless your sin is treated by the blood of his son Jesus Christ, if you die in your sin, the proverb says, the tree lies where it falls, There's no shifting it afterwards. You fall out of this world in your sin. That's how you remain for all eternity in the damnation of hell. Now is the time. Now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation, says God. While you're still breathing, while you still got the faculty of reason within you, bring it to the word of God, he says. Come now, saith the Lord, and let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Bring your sin to Jesus Christ, to the cross of God's Son, the only place of forgiveness, the only one who can deal with your sin, only one who can take it away, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world and would take yours away today, should you come to him in faith, that is, trusting, confiding in the Son of God who loved sinners and gave himself for them. But then, my friends, the law, the moral law of God, the commandments of God, they'll teach you the truth of man's obligation, what it is that God requires of you. You're a moral creature. God made you that way. You did not come that way by means of evolution. Nonsense, utter nonsense, madness, unscientific, false philosophy of man. No, in the beginning God made them male and female. He made men and women after his own image, moral creatures, morally accountable. Obliged, you have an obligation to your Maker, and God will require you, requires of you, a demand total and absolute obedience to the will of God. But what man, what woman is it of you in Canada today who could possibly offer anything like a total and a complete obedience to God? You were conceived in sin, you were born in sin, and you live in and you delight in sin all your days, unless God changes you, unless God transforms you, unless God redeems you. Born in sin, living in sin, and dying in sin, my friend, never having fulfilled the obligation that you have to your Maker. Obedience. God requires obedience of you to his commandments. But you cannot, because you're a sinner by nature. And so you quite naturally sin. You quite naturally. You quite naturally do that which is contrary to God's will. That's your nature. That's your wicked nature that you got from your parents by natural generation. That's your sinful, wicked nature that delights in sin, that delights in disobedience. You live in disobedience, many of you, to the state, to the government, never mind God. Obey God's law completely, totally. Impossible for you. Impossible. You're impotent. You're powerless. You cannot even overcome your sinful addictions. You know? These addictions, you know, to all manner, all kinds of drugs and alcohol and stuff. All the addictions that fill your society, you cannot even overcome them. But they are just symptoms. They are just symptoms of the greater addiction inside of you. You're addicted to sin. So how can a man or woman, how can a child addicted to sin possibly live out their obligation to God, total and complete obedience? Well, my friend, with you, that's impossible. That's impossible with you. But nothing shall be impossible with God. God has made a way. God, my friends, has provided the means, sending his only begotten Son into the world, that the disobedient could be turned and made obedient. By the Son of God, he came into the world and died and rose again from the dead, paid the price of sin, to wash you, make you clean, to change your heart. Jesus says you must be born again. That nature must be changed. That nature that loves sin, that nature that loves disobedience, that nature must be changed, my friends. It must be turned around, and that's more than you can accomplish. That's more than any man can accomplish. Only God, by Jesus Christ, can accomplish that. Except a man be born again, he cannot see, he cannot obey the will of God, the commandments of God. Impossible! God must come and take the hatred out of your heart. He must come and take the hatred you have for God out of your heart, the hatred you have for your neighbor out of your heart. That's why you go about killing one another all the time. You're never done killing. You're never done murdering one another. If it's not guns and knives, it's abortion and euthanasia. But you're never done killing one another. Because God says, they that hate me love death. And you're living in a society that's in love with death. Never done killing. Never done disobeying the will of God. So unless you're born again, unless God takes that hate out of your heart, unless God takes the heart of stone out of you and gives you a heart of flesh, you will never live in obedience to God's will. But then and only then, my friend, turn down of your disobedience. Turn down of your sinful natures. God causing you by his miraculous and gracious, kind intervention into your hearts, into the depths of your soul, putting his life into you and putting his love into your heart and changing you, making you a new creature in Jesus Christ. That, my friend, a miracle is what's required. Something only God can do, not you. But God still holds you to the obligation. You're obliged to obey him. And if your heart is not changed, if he does not graciously perform the heart surgery upon you, in that day when you stand before him in judgment, you will pay the price for your disobedience. So you say, that's the way I want to go. Then you go ahead. You go and drink your fill. You go and live out your disobedience. But be warned, today you face the damnation of hell. God will bring you to judgment for your disobedience. Repent ye and believe the gospel today. The moral law of God, you see, teach you man's state, what it is that you really are. I'm a good person, you say. I do good, you say. That's contrary to God's word. He says there's none good, not even you. He says there's none that doeth good, not even you. There's none righteous, no, not one, says God. Not at all. So you're not a good person, and you don't do good. The only goodness that registers with God is if it's done through faith in Jesus Christ. Otherwise, it counts for nothing. It counts for sin. So you see, my friend, man's true nature. Well, bring your nature to God's moral law. Bring your nature, bring what you are, bring your whole being, bring it to the commandments of God and see what kind of a person you are. And you'll find out that you're an idolater. You'll find out that you're a murderer. You'll find out that you're sexually immoral. You'll find out that you're a coveter. You'll find out that you're a liar. All men are liars, says God. Every single one of you. So you see, that's your true nature. That's what you really are. Walking, breathing, talking sin. Just a lump of, with nothing, I tell you, nothing that you could bring to God that would be acceptable to him. But that's what God's moral law is given to us for. By the knowledge of the law is the knowledge of sin. Your sinful nature, your sinful practice, what it is that you are, your desperate state and condition. Sin is in your DNA. It's the very fabric of your being. With every breath that you take, you sin. Every thought and every word. My friends, that state and that condition can only be changed by God himself. Transformed by the grace of God. Why you need the grace of God? Why you need my gospel? Because my gospel and my gospel alone is the power of God unto salvation. The power to change that vile nature of yours. The power to change your vile practice. A change that only the power of God can accomplish. And God, in sending his Son into the world to give us this good news, this glad tidings of great joy, I tell you, that there is salvation to be found, that God has made provision for wicked sinners like you, that you might be redeemed from the curse of God that lies upon the entire human race because of man's sin. In a sin-cursed and sin-filled world, good news, glad tidings, free grace, declared amongst you here today in Cannock Town, that men and women who hear the gospel, hear with the hearing of the ear, and hearing with the hearing of the soul, not just the outward hearing, but hearing the voice of God's grace within you, calling you out of your sinful nature, calling you out of your wickedness, and calling you to his Son Jesus Christ in the way of repentance and faith towards the Son of God. But oh, I tell you, the moral law of God, it's of much use. Much use, I tell you. Educate yourself. Get yourself to God's commandments. Not got a Bible, I'll give you one. Exodus chapter 20. Read those commandments for yourself. God's moral demands upon you, his moral creatures. An obligation to obey him to the uttermost, but in total failure. My of rebellion, but salvation. Salvation because the moral law of God was never given to us, my friends, to save us. Trying to keep God's commandments, that will never rectify your nature. That will never make you right. That will never bring you the favor of God. The grace of God is free, my friend. The grace of God is utterly free. Free to the uttermost. God gives it freely to whosoever he pleases to give it to. And how does he give it? How does he bring men to salvation? How does he bring men to faith in his Son that they might be saved? How does he do it? By this that I'm doing here today, preaching the gospel to you. Working that faith in you. Because he must, because you can't. Because you haven't got the power to believe. You haven't got the power to change yourself. You haven't got the power to obey God. He commands you. Oh, he commands you. And doesn't take away your responsibility just because you cannot. The fact that you cannot obey God is your fault. The fact that you cannot believe, that's your fault. That's your responsibility. God commands it of you, and you ought to do it, and you'll be judged for not doing it. Oh, please, my friends, understand you are accountable, morally accountable before God. And you will give account in that day. But through the preaching of the gospel, God graciously, I tell you, yes, even in these apostate days, even in these days of declension and decline, even in these wicked days, my friends, God, by the preaching of his holy gospel, I tell you, my friends, he gives faith to men and women and brings them to call upon his name, the name of his dear Son, that they might be saved, that they might be received of God, their natures changed, reborn. But you see, my friends, the law, the moral law of God, it's of great use, you see, to instruct and to educate you. It's what the law of God, the commandments of God were given for, to educate you. And here you are, some of you, with gray hair like myself, and you've not even learned the ABCs of the gospel. Never mind the deep mysteries of God. Perishing without knowledge of the kind of sinner it is that you are, of how far it is that you're away from God, from your best good, from your Maker, and the one who one day will bring you to judgment. Oh, to be in a state such as you're in today, in this society, in this town of yours today, where wickedness, evil abounds. Oh, my friends, are there many saved? The question was asked of Jesus. Answer, no. No, not many. Not many, but if you truly believe, you will be saved. God's moral law, his commandments, given to us, my friend, to show you your need, your desperate need of Jesus Christ. When the law does its work, when the commandment does its work, when it declares you effectively to be a thief and a robber, to be a murderer, to be sexually immoral, when the law of God comes to you effectively and pronounces the death sentence on you, the judgment of God over you, then only when God makes it effectual, only when God works it effectively in your soul, then, my friend, oh, then and only then will you see your need. Then, my friend, then you'll cry. Then I tell you, you'll swim shark-infested waters to get to Jesus Christ. Because he alone can save you. Not Moses, not the law, not the commandments of God. Jesus Christ alone. None other name under heaven whereby we must be saved. Christ. Conformity to God's law is found in him, in his perfection. Hey, my friends, who kept it perfectly to the uttermost, lived a life that you did not, have not, cannot, lived a blameless life. I went to that cross, dying for sinners, dying for men and women, lost and ruined by sin, blinded by the God of this age, darkened in their filthy, unclean, and unbelieving mind. Jesus died for such. Died, my friends, for wicked, vile sinners, ungodly, unrighteous, unholy, alienated from God in time, and to be alienated from God for all eternity in the damnation of hell, unless the Son of God, who loved sinners, unless he loves you, unless, my friends, he brings you to God, unless he deals with your sin, unless he takes your sin away. But if you do not believe that I am he, says Jesus, you will die in your sin and go to a lost eternity. That's the end of lawbreakers. That's the end of commandment breakers. The damnation of hell. Eternal burnings, my friend. And so I call upon you today, my friend, turn from your sin. Turn before you burn in the torments of hell forever. Because that's the end of your lawlessness. That's the end of your sin that God hates with every fiber of his being. But sent in love, sent his Son, his only begotten Son, into the world, that through him a sinner such as you might be saved. Saved, my friend. Oh, be assured. All come short of the glory of God. All natural born sinners. All come short of the glory of God. Powerless. Powerless to repair. Powerless to restore yourself to God's favor. To lift even one single little finger to help yourself. And in need of the grace of God. Payment is due, my friends. Payment is due. You're in debt to God. You've got an obligation of debt to your Maker. Payment is due. God will require payment of you. Unless that is his Son has paid the price for your sin. Unless that is you've repented of your sin. Unless that is you've believed in the name of God's only Son. Forgiveness, reconciliation, one way and one way only, Jesus, the mighty Son of God, sent into the world to this end that through his obedience and his sacrifice, his precious blood shed for sinners, wash and make you clean. Get yourself to Christ today. Don't be late. Who knows, my friends, the time when you breathe your last and go out of this world. Today, my friends, tomorrow, New Year's Eve, New Year's Day. Will you see another new year? Will you see another day? Who knows but God alone? But the time is coming. It has been appointed. The time is coming. It is appointed unto man. What's today? After that, the judgment. After that, the judgment. You die. You breathe your last at God's appointed time, not yours. And then you stand immediately in the presence of Almighty God and you give account for all your lawless deeds. So I bid you today, my friends, go to Jesus Christ. Go to Christ and live. Go to Christ. He'll give you light, love, liberty. He'll give you salvation. Because salvation is to be found in none other name under heaven. Not Muhammad's name. Not in the Pope of Rome's name. One name only. The Son of God, Jesus Christ, whom I declare to you this day, who kept the moral law of God, who obeyed God, who died for sinners, who rose again from the dead to save sinners, to bring them to God, reconcile them to God, and bring them to a knowledge of God's love, his favor, his free grace, my friends, declared amongst you here this afternoon in Cannock Town. Will there be a day when you will be required to make payment for your lawless deeds? Will there be a day, my friends, come shortly when you'll stand before God and give account for this time when you heard the gospel of God, when you heard the overtures of his love, but you would have none of it. It was nothing, nothing to you that the Son of God should live and die and rise again from the dead, that a lawless sinner, a lawbreaker such as you, might be saved. My friends, hear the admonition of the Lord Jesus himself. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Why? Because the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel, Cannock. Repent ye and believe the gospel. For the kingdom of God is at hand. Like a copy of God's word. Check these things out for yourselves. See that they are so according to God's word. Offered to you freely, no cost, no obligation to you. You're simply and only for the taking. Like a copy of God's word, you come and ask for one. Gladly place into your hand. May God bless you, Cannock. May God bless you and have mercy, mercy, I say, upon your precious, precious, never dying souls.